Thank you for joining us. I'm with the Honorable Joy Flowers Conti, Senior Judge of the United States District Court for the Western District of Pennsylvania. And Judge Conti, I appreciate you being here and agreeing to participate in this trailblazing project of the Pennsylvania Bar Association Commission on Women in the Profession. The WIP Oral History Project is an illumination into the trailblazers in the legal profession, women who have really set the pace for all of us and who have set the tone in the practice of law and who will serve as inspirations to all of us. So again, thank you for joining me today. Judge Conti is the 49th Commission Judge of the United States District Court for the Western District of Pennsylvania. And Judge Conti is a first in so many respects within our profession and within our Bar Association. Judge, tell us a bit about the early days before you became a judge and before you practiced law.
Well, I grew up traveling around the world since my father was in the Army. So I'm an Army brat. And we had the opportunity to live for many years in Germany, in Heidelberg, Munich, and it was a very broadening education. But I wound up not knowing any lawyers. So I did not know one lawyer because we were generally on various bases where we didn't have much interaction with what would be the JAG Corps, you know, the lawyers in the Army. So I really didn't know any lawyers. But my father, who was a very, very bright man, never had the opportunity to go to college or law school, and he would have been a great lawyer. And so he often spoke about his dream to have been a lawyer. And so that always stuck in my mind, you know, that that would be something that would be worthwhile doing. And it was mainly because of my father and what he didn't get a chance to do. So when I came back to go to college, we were in Munich at the time. We didn't know where my father was going to be stationed. It was during the height of the Vietnam War, so there was a lot of uncertainty. And I applied to various colleges, primarily because my guidance counselor at the time in Munich asked, you know, where I would like to go to college. And I said, well, it should be somewhere in the Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania area, because that's where my father was from. And I had a number of aunts and uncles who were living here, so that no matter where my parents were stationed, I would have somebody that if I needed to go home to for a holiday, if it was too far to visit my family, I could do so. So I wound up looking particularly in the Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania area. And my guidance counselor mentioned Duquesne University. And she said that would be a good place to apply. And that's what I did. And I received a small scholarship at the time to help my family. My brother was a year ahead of me. And fortunately, he received a full scholarship to attend Virginia Military Institute. Wow. So my parents, who didn't have a lot of money, then were able to give me some money so that I could afford to go to a private university, which was Duquesne University.
What a wonderful story. What a wonderful background. And it clearly laid the groundwork for all of the support that you show to everyone today. So, Judge, you came back to Pittsburgh to attend college at Duquesne University, and you then attended Duquesne Law School. So clearly you found your calling while you were at the university. Tell us about your path to the law school.
Well, I was very active in a number of organizations when I was in undergraduate school, and I was a political science major, and I had always had this idea in the back of my mind about going to law school. So it was in my senior year, and I was looking around to see what I would do about perhaps going to law school. And since I didn't know any lawyers, I was unsure about the process. But fortunately, there was a woman who was an RA at the time, and she was in law school, and that was Danetta Ambrose.
Oh my gosh.
And so I went and I visited her, and I asked her how she went to law school, how was she able to do it. And so she told me what Carolos Mansman had told her, because she knew Carol was when she was in law school, and Carol helped her fashioned the pathway to be able to go to law school. And so what it was is to take the LSATs, and in those days we didn't study for the LSATs, just rolled out of bed in the morning and took the test. And she said, when you get your score, you know, go down to Duquesne Law School, and there's a, you know, meet with the one dean, mm-hmm. and you have good grades. If you get a good LSAT score, you know, he will help you. And so that's what I did. And I went down there and they gave me a scholarship. So I was able to go to law school and not have to pay anything, especially then after my first year, I became first in my class, and you got an automatic scholarship after that. So it was, I'm very grateful to Duquesne University because I was able to go to law school and not have a serious debt when I graduated.
What a wonderful story of firsts. Mm-hmm. And as we all know, Judge Carol Lose Mansman was the first woman to serve on the bench for the United States District Court in the Western District of Pennsylvania. And Judge Ambrose was the second. And you, of course, followed their paths.
Right.
And what a wonderful story of firsts.
It's just a nice connection
yes.
all the way through.
Yes, and the support that
people
they
people helping
showed.
People, and
yes.
that's what it's about. And women helping women, and sometimes we don't do enough of that.
Absolutely, and I think that's one of the reasons your story is so relevant and is so inspiring to all of us, because you are a perfect example of women having supported you and you supporting other women. And you have demonstrated that throughout your career. And as I understand, when you graduated from law school, you ultimately became the first woman hired at the law firm that is now known as Kirkpatrick Lockhart.
Well, it's now known as K.L. Gates.
K.L. Gates, okay. I'm showing my age, aren't I?
It's okay.
So, Judge, as I understand it, among your many firsts is the first woman to be hired as an associate
yes.
at what is now K.L. Gates.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about that.
At the time, I was in law school, naturally, when you're applying to get to become an associate. And since I was first in my class, I'd had a tradition at Duquesne for the law review that the editor-in-chief would be the person who was number one in the class. Mm-hmm. And there was a great deal of concern among the members of the editorial board of the law review because they'd never had a woman be the editor-in-chief, mm-hmm. and that's the mm-hmm. command position.
Yeah.
That's the lead role for the law review, which is the premier scholarship and academic journal that's produced by the law school.
So, Judge, as your career path began to take shape, and you were the first in your class in law school, which made you the first editor-in-chief of the law review, as I understand it, tell us about that.
Okay. And I have a funny story to tell you before I talk about
okay.
that.
Okay. Right.
In terms of becoming first in the class, there were only six women in my class. We had 140 students in our day division, and we had six women. And we felt that was a big group of women because prior to that, if there were one or two women, you know, that was fortunate.
Mm-hmm.
So here we had a class starting in 1970 of six women. But the men did not want to be in a study group with us. You know, that was something that was done at law school at that
yeah.
time.
Yeah.
You would get a small group of the students and you would study together, and there was called a study group. So the men didn't want us to be part of their study group, so we formed our own study group. And we had just women because none of the men wanted to be with us. Mm-hmm. And we would we worked hard but differently from the men because of the various commitments that each of us had. One was working, you know, part-time. One was married and lived out in Greensburg. And I was married at the time in my second semester of law school. And so we had to devise a way for us to work efficiently. And so what we would do was start on Friday night. We'd start, you know, around 5 or 6 o'clock in the evening, and we would work through the night until 7 o'clock the next morning. And we would put together outlines for all the courses that we had that week. And at the end of the year, and I attribute, you know, a lot of my success in law school to the study group, we had three out of the five were on the law review and in the top 10. So we did very well as women in our time at the law school. What? So when I became number one in the law school, which was a surprise to my husband, who was sure I was going to be flunking out, but I did do very well. And at that time, they'd never had a woman editor-in-chief before. And so there was a lot of concern among the members of the editorial board about whether I, as a woman, would, one, want the job, and two, would be able to do the job.
Yeah.
And so as soon as I heard that they thought I wouldn't want the job or wouldn't be able to do it, I said, well, of course I want it. And so I put my name in, and they did give it to me, because it's hard not to if they've always done that in the past. And we had a good group. You know, there were a lot of men. We were all friends. We all worked together. And we had a very good law review that year. And I'm proud of the success that we had of that law review, and being able to show that it didn't matter whether you were a man or woman, as long as you had the right set of skills, you know, you could produce a good product, which was our law review.
What a wonderful.
And that helped me then to get the position at Kirkpatrick, Lockhart and Johnson at the time, which is now K&L Gates. They had never had a woman before, and there was one other woman in town that was an associate at Reed Smith. So in the big firms, that's what I'm talking about, in the large firms. And they were small, by in today's comparison, they would be small firms. But at that time, they were the big firms in town, Reed Smith, Kirkpatrick, Lockhart, and Johnson. And so I interviewed, and I felt very comfortable with the people at Kirkpatrick, Lockhart, and Johnson, now K&L Gates. They were wonderful. The leaders at the time were all men who had come through World War II, and they had originally been with Reed Smith. And when they came back from the war, they were there briefly, and then they decided to form their own firm, which they did. And I was the first woman associate to be hired there in 1972. So in the summer of 72, I was the first woman associate. And we had a big group. There were five of us, only five.
Oh,
that day, that was a big group.
Yeah.
But I knew I had to work really hard at that stage to show that I was able to compete with the men.
And you had that link because of your upbringing, with your father having been in the military, and they came from World War II.
I felt very comfortable with that.
So it was a natural, it was a good natural fit.
Yes, it was.
And that's, and of course then you were raising a family at this time. So all of that had to be juggled, so to speak.
Yes, it had to be juggled. But when I was a summer associate and they came in to give me an offer about coming to work as an associate, I said to them, I intend to have a family, and if that's a problem for you, tell me now and I'll look for something else. And they said, oh no, absolutely, we wouldn't want you any other way. So I knew then that I would be able to have a family and practice law at that firm. And that wasn't necessarily the case in other parts of the country. So I was really proud of that, of my firm, that they did that, and they made me feel comfortable. So of course then, when I became pregnant, I went in and I reminded my hiring partner, do you remember when I told you I was going to have a family? I said, well, now I'm going to have a baby. And so it worked out.
And so there were congratulations all around.
Yes.
And you were comfortable telling them that because you had laid the groundwork.
Right. In fact, they asked me, I asked them, what is your maternity policy? And they said, well, gee, we don't have one. They said, what would you like? And I said, well, I think 3 months off with full pay would be nice. And they said, okay.
Oh,
so
my gosh.
That set the tone for the maternity policy.
So again, another number of firsts. Then we get into the maternity policy.
Right.
And you, again, laid the groundwork with maternity leave policy at your firm. Tell us about that.
Well, when I told them that I was expecting, and I asked them, what is the maternity policy? And they said, well, we've never had a maternity policy. What would you like? And I thought about it, and I said, I think 3 months off with pay would be nice. So that's what I would like. And they said, okay. And so that became the maternity policy at the firm. And I think that was, it was wonderful to have that time with my baby.
And that shows your support for women again, mm-hmm. because once again, you're laying the groundwork for those who would follow that career path and who now have a maternity policy in place and who have the opportunity to spend time with their babies as they're born. So tell us about raising your family while you were practicing law.
It's a challenge. And whether you're a man or a woman, if you have a family, it is very difficult because the practice of law, whether you're in a large firm or a small firm or a corporate setting, it's very demanding. It requires a great amount of time commitment if you're going to practice law. And as I had my children, I first had my first child when I was at the law firm, and then I was recruited to go to Duquesne University School of Law, and I became a professor there, and I had my second son while I was a professor, and I can remember being very pregnant, teaching my last class, and right after the school year ended, but before I had graded the exams, I delivered my son. And I can recall the dean calling me at home, you know, and I was just been home a day or two saying, where are those blue books? Where are your grades? Are you ready? Yeah. So I was madly at home grading my exams, but I did get them in on time. So that worked out. But it was fortunate then I had the rest of the summer to be off with my family. And then I went back to work. My third son I had when I became a full professor then.
Yes.
I was teaching corporations, civil procedure, bankruptcy, business reorganizations, and corporate finance. So I was teaching all those courses in the business area. But I really had wanted to see if I could become a partner at Kirkpatrick. That was always been a goal of mine, and it was in the back of my mind after I had my tenure. It was a good time, I thought, to go back to practice, and I wanted to do business bankruptcies, and that was a time in the early 80s when we had a large number of very mega bankruptcy cases here in our Western District of Pennsylvania, and I was fortunate that the law firm thought it would be a great idea too, so I went back to Kirkpatrick Lockhart at that time, and I had my third son when I was back, and I was fortunate again to have the same maternity policy of the 3 months when I had my third son.
And when you went back as having been the first fully tenured professor at Duquesne Law in a substantive area of
yes.
the law. And,
yes.
and of course, that's the business and the corporations.
Yes.
And this is what led you into the bankruptcy field. And
yes.
you handled not just bankruptcies, but the complex Chapter 11 business bankruptcies.
Yes.
So tell us about your return to private practice after having been the first tenured professor in a substantive area of law.
It was very demanding, extremely demanding. I wanted to become a partner, and I became a partner a year later. But I had to demonstrate to everyone there that I was really committed, and this wasn't just something I would do and then leave again, that it was something that I was dedicated to. Mm-hmm. And whether you're a man or a woman, if you want to be a partner, you have to work very hard. Mm-hmm. You have to have a lot of hours. You have to demonstrate that you can obtain the confidence of the clients, that they trust you with their work, with their most significant concerns and projects that they have. And I found that that was rewarding. It was challenging, but I would work through the night many times when I was getting ready to become a partner. Yeah. And then fortunately I did become a partner, but the work didn't stop.
Yeah.
It continued to be extremely demanding for the rest of the time that I was in private practice.
And yet you still found time to give back to the community and to the organization, such as the Pennsylvania Bar Association, where you chaired the business law section, and where you received numerous awards, too many awards for me to go through all of them, but I'm going to ask you a bit about all of the other involvement you had that supported and mentored all attorneys, including women attorneys. Tell us about that.
Well, when I first started in the practice of law, I was encouraged by the firm to get involved with my local bar association, the Allegheny County Bar Association. And I did, and I found it to be really a wonderful networking opportunity, an opportunity to be challenged by different areas, by different lawyers, and to create friendships. And I became the first woman to chair the Young Lawyers Division at the time, and for our local bar association. And I also became, at the same time, involved because of the connection with our local bar and the Pennsylvania Bar, became very active in the Pennsylvania Bar Association. And through the Pennsylvania Bar Association, I became a delegate to the American Bar Association Young Lawyers Division. And I remember as a young lawyer going to many meetings with the Pennsylvania Bar Association in Tough Trees over in the eastern part of the state, and creating a lot of good working relationships on a statewide basis. And that's when I first became involved with the business law section. And they are the section that has a committee, which I became a member of, that develops the business laws for the state of Pennsylvania. So they really work and make recommendations to our state legislature about keeping our business laws up to, you know, the appropriate standards on a national basis, so that it's attractive for our businesses to be incorporated here or to form as an LLC or another business type entity. And that was a wonderful experience for me, because then you, as a lawyer, can change the law. You know, you can do really important work, and it was really a tribute to the Pennsylvania Bar Association. And so through that, I became very active in the Pennsylvania Bar Association's House of Delegates. And then I was fortunate enough that they appointed me to, I worked with the, actually, it was the Allegheny County Bar Association that sent me to the American Bar Association House of Delegates. So I was in the Pennsylvania House of Delegates, the American Bar Association House of Delegates, and there was a lot of overlap, too, in terms of the kinds of issues both groups were looking at. And that eventually led to my being requested to become the first woman at large member of governor of the sitting on the governing board of the Pennsylvania Bar Association, which was a real privilege.
And you served us so well in that role. You were a member of the Commission on Women in the Profession of the PBA. And when you were asked to be the first woman at large governor, it was an honor for the PBA because of your many accomplishments. And I'm certain you must have found the Board of Governors to be a wonderful experience. Tell us about that experience, being the first woman at large governor.
Well, it certainly was a challenge, you know, because it's a big time commitment, of naturally, and it involves quite a bit of travel. I had been the president of the Allegheny County Bar Association, and there was some travel with that to the Pennsylvania Bar meetings mainly. But when you become involved with the Pennsylvania Bar, it's really a statewide bar, and we would have meetings around the states, around the state. We had a lot of challenges going on, particularly with trying to raise money for the Legal Services Corporation so that we could make sure that the poorest people in our state are able to get legal services on the civil side. And it's, you know, was a concern at that time as to how we could develop that.
And you served as a chair of the PBA Task Force on Legal Service for the Poor.
Yes, and that was the one big challenge. And that was trying to find a way to see if we could get some funding on a more permanent basis for legal services for the poor throughout the state. And we had, we wanted to go out to the bar, and this is one of the things I'm most proud about, not about me, but about our lawyers in Pennsylvania, I was tasked with the western part of the state to go to all of the local bar associations in the western part of the state to see if we could get their members who were in the House of Delegates to support a commitment by a lawyer to devote a certain amount of time every year to doing pro bono work. Because we felt if we could show the legislature that the lawyers in Pennsylvania were willing to put their time and effort into providing legal services, that we should have a statute passed where we could get some funding from every filing that was made in the Commonwealth, that a portion of that could go towards providing legal services to the poor. But we felt we had to show that we were willing to do it as members of the profession in Pennsylvania. And I was so proud after we did all of that effort, the Pennsylvania Bar Association did vote to have a commitment for the lawyers. It's not a mandatory commitment, but it's a commitment by the members of the bar that it's important to do pro bono work. And I was very proud of our lawyers for standing up and doing that.
And again, you were a trailblazer in that regard. The Board of Governors has the pro bono policy mm-hmm. that is followed to this mm-hmm. day, where each of the members is mm-hmm. asked to show their commitment. And pro bono work is very near and dear to all of our hearts. And your commitment to that is impacting us still. And that's another wonderful facet of your career path, because everything that you have done has had this ripple effect that has been felt by so many women and so many lawyers, clients, and the communities. And even though you were a partner in a major law firm, you chose to give back to the community again by agreeing to accept an appointment to the bench. Tell us about that.
At the time, I was a business bankruptcy lawyer, and so my experience of going to court would be before a federal bankruptcy court. And I did not have any trial experience in the sense that one would typically think of a litigator. But I had always thought that it would be a wonderful opportunity to do justice if you could be a federal district judge. And we had 5 vacancies at the time. There hadn't been a judge appointed to the bench in over 8 years. So we did have, half our bench was vacant at the time. And a friend of mine, Danetta Ambrose, suggested, there's so many vacancies, you know, you might have a shot at it, you know, because I had a lot of other skills, and I did have litigation skills, albeit in the bankruptcy arena, but I had had a number of other things that I had done to show a commitment to the interest of justice. And so I thought about it and said, yes, I think this would be something that I could do something to help others again in a more concrete way. And I put my name in, and surprisingly to many people, I was one of the nominees. And that was a real challenge, you know, because they would ask me, well, now you've never had a trial. What are you going to do? You've never represented a criminal defendant. What are you going to do? And my answer was, just as I had done throughout my career, I'm a very fast study. I'm a real hard worker. And I would do everything in my power to be ready to sit on the bench and to do the best job possible.
And that is certainly what has happened. Mm-hmm. Everyone knows that your time on the bench continues to be an inspiration for all of us. In fact, you've received many awards, and professionalism is among those awards. And I know that that is something that you're very proud of. I'd like you to tell us about that. It was the American Inns of Court, am I correct?
Yes, for the Third Circuit. I was nominated by my inn, where I'd served for many years as the counselor of the inn, and they nominated me. To my surprise, I received a call from one of the judges on the Third Circuit to say, well, you've been selected by the American Inns of Court to receive the Professionalism Award for the Third Circuit. And that was a big honor.
Again, more firsts. Mm. So you have followed this wonderful career path that has been an inspiration to all of us. And you've received so many awards that I can't list them all, but I can try to highlight a few, one of which is the Women in Profession Annex Alpern Award.
Yes, that was near and dear to my heart as well, too, because that is an award by my fellow women lawyers and judges who, on a statewide basis, recognized me, and I was extremely flattered by that and honored to have that recognition.
And I know you've also received the W. Edward Sell Award, and you are rightfully so very proud of that as well.
Yes, that's from the business law section, and it recognizes my commitment to the commercial law interests that I was mm-hmm. devoted a great number of my years to and enhancing our state on a statewide basis, our business laws.
So as you continued your career on the bench, the Chief Justice appointed you to some very important positions, and you agreed to accept the service in those positions. Tell us about that.
Well, one, it was dear and dear to my heart because it has to do with the bankruptcy. And I had been a longtime practitioner in the bankruptcy world. They have a committee that is part of the Judicial Conference, just so you understand. The Judicial Conference is the governing body for all of the policy and administrative matters that affect the federal courts nationwide. And one of those committees deals with the administration of the bankruptcy system. And so the Chief Justice initially appointed me to be a member of that committee. And there are like 13 or 14 members of the committee. And then he appointed me to be the chair to represent the whole committee before the Judicial Conference. And that was a big honor, and it required a lot of work. I traveled extensively throughout the United States and trying to bring to the attention of the entire federal judiciary the needs and interests of the bankruptcy courts. And then I had the opportunity, since I became the chief judge of my court, to be the representative of the Third Circuit to the Judicial Conference itself. And that was a big honor as well, because that is the policy-making body, and it's chaired by the Chief Justice of the United States.
What a wonderful accomplishment. What a wonderful list of accomplishments.
Yes, and opportunities.
Opportunities.
Right.
What wonderful opportunities mm-hmm. that you stepped up to the plate, and again, you were blazing the trail. And you continued to do that with a diversion program that you facilitated as chief judge.
Yes.
Am I correct?
Yes. As the chief judge, I was invited to see if my court would want to participate in a program to be looking at ways to improve our criminal justice system. And we participated initially in a program down in Washington, D.C. We were one of just maybe 10 courts around the country that were selected to go to this program. And we brought representatives from our U.S. Attorney's Office, our Federal Defender's Office, probation, and the court. And they encouraged us to think about ways to approach the criminal justice system in terms of reducing recidivism and helping people avoid going to prison. So what were the best ways to do that? And so we put a group together here, which I chaired, and we call it Smart on Crime, and we met periodically, at least every other month, and one of the programs that came out of that was what we called our diversion court, and it's named Bridges, and it is gives an opportunity for people who are facing indictment. To avoid indictment, they go into a diversion program where they have to accomplish certain things under supervision, or if they are still need to have the to plead to the crime, they will get probation. So they avoid going into the prison system that enables them to be able to keep a job, maintain their family, support their family, and hopefully never commit a crime again. And so that was the thrust of that program. We had several other aspects of things that we were working on to affect criminal justice locally, but that was one main accomplishment that came out of that, out of my time of chairing that committee.
So, Judge, you have been creating bridges throughout your entire career, and that continues to this day. Serving as a senior judge, I'm certain your workload is no less, and that you are always looking for ways to help other people. So tell us how you continue that to this day as a senior judge.
Well, as a senior judge, I continue to take virtually a full caseload, at least for the time being. I have a little flexibility in how I do that, but mostly I try to provide important educational programs. I speak and lecture nationally on electronic discovery. We have a very robust electronic discovery set of rules here locally, and I'm serving presently on the Sedona Conference's group that is looking at electronic discovery and how documents should be sealed or not sealed in the federal courts. That's an area of some controversy, particularly for the bar. We've had a patent pilot project here in the Western District of Pennsylvania, and I serve on the Sedona Conference's working group that developed best practices for judges in patent cases. I am serving as a judge in multi-district litigation, which is you're designated by a national panel of federal judges to receive cases from all over the country and try to administer those to hopefully have a resolution via settlement, and if not, to do all of the pretrial work leading up to trial. And I have one of those today, which is an antitrust case, a railroad antitrust case, and I'm busy working on that, and that requires a great deal of work as well. And I'm also serving on, cybersecurity is another area that I have an interest in, and I do quite a bit of lecturing in that area. So it's e-discovery, cybersecurity, and patent law, which I've been focusing on going out around the country, lecturing and trying to help the bar understand how judges are viewing what the issues are so they can perceive the best ways to handle cases in those areas.
So, Judge, you have been mentoring and teaching and educating and guiding lawyers throughout your career, starting when you were in law school and you were editor-in-chief of the Law Review, and when you were a tenured professor at Duquesne Law. And on the bench, you continue those educational projects.
Yes, in fact, I just want to tell you this one story. I was just last weekend in Chicago talking about patent law, and one of the topics that came up was how are women doing? And it's not doing very well. There's only 12% of the lead chairs in patent law are women in litigation. And so when you ask me about how things were then and how they're now, there have been improvements, yes. But a lot of the issues that I was talking about as a young lawyer are still facing women today. And it's really how to get into today. It's not getting your initial level job, you know, that has been accomplished, but it's really being able to move up and to have more responsible positions within the firms and recognition as to your ability to lead, to be the lead trial lawyer in a complex case. And that's been really hard for women to do. And there's a lot of efforts that are being undertaken by the judiciary, by private firms now, to enhance the ability of any minority to be on a level playing field and be able to move up. So at this meeting, there was a young woman who kept smiling at me. She was African-American, and she was smiling at me throughout the program, and she came up to me afterwards and introduced herself. And she's from a Southern law school, and she said, are there any opportunities, you know, to become a federal clerk? And over the years, I've taken a lot of interns during the summertime. I think it's important to bring them in so they can see how a judge thinks, what happens behind the scenes in the judge's chambers. And I said to her, I said, well, if you want to come, I said, I didn't take any last year. I said, but if you want to come, if I can't find another judge that is interested, I said, I will take you, because I think it's so important, particularly for minorities, and the women of color have it even worse than other women who don't have the double effect of the double minority issues. And I think it's important, and we all need to do that. We need to open the door, and that's what's important. You got to open the door, and the person that the door is open for has to come through.
What a wonderful example you are setting for all of us. You are opening those doors, you are welcoming all of us in, and you're welcoming the young attorneys and the young professionals who see someone who gives them illumination into what the practice of law can and should be. And I know that you have a wonderful legacy. I'd like to know what your thoughts are on what you'd like that legacy to be.
When I think back, you know, if you go back on my life in terms of where I was able to come from, not knowing a lawyer, being the first woman in my family to graduate from college, and I'm talking about my cousins, my extended family, to think that I could be a federal judge today is just is something that I could only have really dreamed about and thought couldn't be possible. But it became possible. But 100 years from now, I don't know who's going to be remembering it. So at the end of the day, you know, what you accomplish is not so much looking at the awards that are on the wall. I was thinking about this the other day. Who's going to take care of these? Is anybody going to want them? Where are they going to go? And they will all be gone. And what's going to be left is, have I done anything that has helped another person in this life, so that they can have a better life? And hopefully I've been able to do that through my various roles that I've had. And if I can have made a difference in someone's life, then I don't know how those things will ripple through the ages, but hopefully that would be the legacy.
Judge, I can assure you that that legacy is already here. And 100 years from now, we will all remember what a wonderful example you've set for all of us. You've opened doors and you've created opportunities. And for that, we thank you.